Hello! Hello, everyone. Good evening. We are live and in person at AABANY Wall Street. Who's excited about that? Anybody? I am so glad to see you all, not in front of a Zoom screen, not in Brady Bunch style. So great to see you, and I have to say, you all look great. You all look marvelous. Give yourselves a big hand. My name is Young Chen. I'm the executive director of the Asian American Bar Association of New York. And it gives me great pleasure to introduce Kate Rigg, our master of ceremonies. Artist activist Kate Siahan Rigg is a New York-based Asian American artist and activist. She writes, performs, and produces work for television, film, stage, and dive bars around the world. You have seen Kate recurring on NBC's New Amsterdam, Fox's Family Guy, The Dr. Phil Show, where she served as a comedy correspondent for 3 seasons, and as a guest star on Law and Order SVU, The Path, Tales of the City, Law and Order, and Law and Order Criminal Intent. And now she's in a room full of lawyers. As a killer Amerasian MC, she has toured with her rock comedy spoken word duo, Slanty-Eyed Mama, all over the world, and recorded 2 hit festival theater concert hybrids. In response to the rise of violence against Asian Americans, she is hosting and curating a new show at Joe's Pub, the public theater, to uplift, amplify, and connect incredible Asian American artists. And in fact, folks, that show is Monday night, May 2nd, get your tickets now. Kate has also recently been named Chief Creative Officer at the New Center for Diversity and Disability based in Cincinnati, Ohio. Ladies and gentlemen, Kate Rigg.
Hi, everybody. I'm so excited to be here. I was with you virtually last year on the Zoom, and I'm happy to be here. That was a very nice introduction, Young, reading directly from my website. I appreciate all the shout-outs to my credits since the early 2000s. Yes, I have been on every single Law and Order franchise in New York City, except for the recent one, which I'm hoping to get on as a, you know, I'm Asian, so I'm usually a forensic scientist or a lawyer, hardly ever a public defender because, you know, we like our Gucci. I also like, I can't believe I brought this on stage. This is my ginger drink that I brought from home, so now you know I'm a legit Asian person when I have to bring my own special ginger tea just to be on stage. Thank you very much. I'm covered in Tiger Balm right now. All right, so I'm here to welcome you all to the 2022, oh, that's very disconcerting, I could see myself. Do you see my shirt? You gotta represent 24/7 right now in 2022. There's a lot of drama in the streets for American Asians, so I like to, I mean, here I'm preaching to the choir, but I wear this shirt everywhere. I just did a thing at Barnard for a global feminist conference, and there was no Asian representation on the stage. And I thought, I'm wearing this shirt. This will be the representation. I'll just walk around the conference, you know, pointing at it, hashtagging everybody. All right. So anyways, I'm here to welcome you to this 2022 AABANY annual dinner and 33rd anniversary celebration. Give yourselves a round of applause. 33 years and just getting stronger and more vocal every year, as lawyers do. Also, you know, this is an award ceremony, and I don't know about you guys, but I have a little tiny PTSD from the whole Will Smith, Chris Rock slap incident that reverberated around the world, and I was told very specifically not to make bald jokes about Kwok Eng. friends are over there, the Kwok Ang friends. Luckily for me, Kwok's wife, Sella, is in Korea right now, giving birth to their first child, so she will not be slapping me across the face. She will instead be bringing another bright Asian American, American Asian, or just Asian light into the world. So congratulations, Kwok Ang. Sorry about the pattern baldness, but you look freaking hot. Let me tell you, you look good. Asian don't raisin, so the whole head is now glowing with beauty. I'm into it. All right. Now, this has been a big year for AABANY. The pro bono program is back in person, which is a major thing, accomplishment. It's happening in Manhattan. They were gonna open in Queens in 2019, but then, of course, hashtag pandemic. Was it 2019 or 2020? 2020, right, so we got the pandemic, but now they're open in Queens. We're about to open in Brooklyn, so again, congratulations to all of us. And one more shout out, is Karen King here tonight? I'm not making a bald joke about you because you look good, girl. No, Karen King recently argued in front of the Supreme Court, everybody. And it was like an international law. It was very dramatic. It was like a Bond movie. There was international law. There was child abduction. There were other Asians on the against in the opposing team, right? So there's all these Asians in front of the Supreme Court shaming their parents for not going to medical school, but making us proud here at AABANY tonight. So congratulations to you, Karen King. We're all very proud of you. And Karen's also the co-chair of the pro bono program that's back in person. So great. Now to kick off, I'm gonna bring to the stage, are you ready, Terry? Are you, I don't see Terry lurking. Where's Terry? Oh, you're right there. So your immediate past president is Terry Shen, who will be kicking us off tonight. I asked everybody before I came here tonight, can you, it's very echoey, right? Like I shouldn't rap or anything right now, because it would just be, all right. But I did ask everybody who I was speaking about tonight to send me some fun facts about themselves, you know, to make it a little more fun for us tonight. So here are some of Terry Shen, your immediate past president's fun facts. I did not make these up. These were sent to me. Terry says, I've lived in London and Hong Kong and have traveled to 20 countries. That's a fun fact. I was an altar boy in Catholic school, which is a cry for help, as well as a fun fact. Also maybe a badge of honor, like going to law school, both a cry for help and a badge of honor. Okay. In junior high, I performed with a rock band on piano. So rebel. I bet your Asian parents were really proud that you took all those lessons they'd been forcing you to take since you were three and went into a rock band. Rock on, Terry Shen. And Cherry tells me that he's dined at the Playboy Mansion with Hugh Hefner and his daughter. You brought your daughter to the Playboy Mansion to dine with Hugh Hefner? Hugh Hefner's daughter. You dined with Hugh Hefner's, I think I need a libel lawyer here right now. Do we have one in the house right now? Or maybe a harassment lawyer? I don't know what's happening. How was it? Was it fun? It was hashtag fun. Hashtag time's up. Okay, so please welcome to the stage, seriously, your immediate past president, Terry Shen.
Hello, hello. Thank you. Thank you very much. It's so good to be back in person at AABANY's 2022 annual dinner and to see so many friends. Our members, sponsors, supporters, guests. I'm Terry Shen, AABANY's immediate past president. Thank you. AABANY is recognized by the media as one of New York's most vocal attorney groups. City and State New York named us to both its prestigious Asian power and legal power lists. Our membership is now over 1,500 paid members. That makes AABANY the largest diverse bar association in the country. Through our Anti-Asian Violence Task Force, we led the national agenda in this area. During the early surges of anti-Asian violence last year, we were in front of the media 3+ hours a day responding to their requests. CNN, The New York Times, National Public Radio, the list goes on and on. Our hybrid pro bono clinics, community service teams, and legal referral and information service, reconfigured for the pandemic, provided housing, unemployment, immigration, rent relief, and small business assistance to communities in need. We had the megaphone, and we amplified the civic dialogue in key areas. We met with Governor Kathy Hochul, who we're pleased is joining us tonight, Mayor Eric Adams's team, the New York City Council, members of Congress, district attorneys, and law enforcement officials. We took on increasing Asian American representation in government, laws restricting abortion rights, implicit bias in the courts, and voter redistricting. We endorsed diverse candidates for the federal and state judiciaries and cabinet-level offices in President Joe Biden's administration. We did a lot this year. Our directors, officers, and volunteers contributed an enormous amount of their personal time to ensuring our success. Board members, committee chairs, and vice chairs, I invite you to please stand up. To my team, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, AABANY's engine room. In my spare time, I'm a partner at Kramer Levin. I'm immensely proud of them for being a platinum sponsor tonight and having provided AABANY with more than a decade of support. To all of our sponsors who share our vision, you have our gratitude. Thank you, Stella, my wife, whose own experience with her family's dedication to public service has provided boundless inspiration. My daughter, Emma, who skipped class to make the trip down from Ithaca to be here tonight. And my mom, Annie. The person we all have to thank for this evening is my successor, Will Eng, whose dedication and energy made tonight outstanding. I know we will see great things from you. Our 2021 seminal report, A Rising Tide of Hate, co-authored with Paul Weiss, addressed the background and solutions to the anti-Asian violence crisis. They provided crucial representation to numerous victims of horrific, high-profile anti-Asian attacks and murders. I am saddened to say the names of Yao Pan Ma, Guiying Ma, and Michelle Goh. Unfortunately, there are many more. We're honored to have Jennifer Wu and Megan Gao of Paul Weiss with us tonight. Also with them is Khan Nguyen, whose mother Hoa was attacked in Brooklyn by a suspect who told police that Chinese people aren't supposed to be in this country. Jennifer, Megan, and Khan, can I invite you to stand? I'd also like to ask everyone else for a bit of help at this point. Through our T3 project, we're working to turn the tide. We would be grateful for your Give Lively support on this. There are 800 of us here at this sold-out gala. If each of us pledged $15 for education, communication, advocacy, and research to turn the tide, we would easily achieve our $10,000 goal for tonight. Please help. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a great evening coming up. I'm so happy you're here to share it with us.
That's your past president, Terry Shen, everybody. Come on, let him know. More fun facts. He's skied since he was 7. He's been on 8 glaciers, and he dove off the Kawarau Bridge, the world's oldest bungee jumping gorge in New Zealand. He's also licensed to pilot a boat. And this kind of at-risk behavior explains your trip to the Playboy Mansion as well. Well done, Terry Shen. You're a go-getter and a daredevil. Oh, I brought the ghost of Ruth Bader Ginsburg with me now because I saw that we have a big screen. So congratulations, Karen King, once again, for arguing in front of the Supreme Court. Bader Ginsburg told me she's very proud of you. And I'm actually really happy to see you all here tonight. Except for maybe Emma, who skipped school. This just shows how far Asian Americans have come in the last decade. That your dad would be bragging that you skipped school to be here and not sending you back to Kumon or extra violin lessons. Instead, you're here eating a beautiful shrimp cocktail, probably underage drinking as well. What's happening, Asian America? What's happening? Oh, see, they've already got the Asian glow. They've had one drink over there at that table. You need to be cut off. Yeah, look at, they're like, does this glass of water make me look drunk? All right, listen, promoting diversity, I'm gonna have Ruth sort of hype man me while I say this. Promoting diversity is one of AABANY's top priorities. And every year, AABANY recognizes a law firm that demonstrates commitment to diversity and inclusion in the profession with respect to recruitment, retention, and advancement of minority attorneys. And this year, the Law Firm Diversity Award goes to, who does it go to, Ruth? Who does it go to? Allen and Overy. Yes, please welcome Sapnapala and John Huang, who will be accepting the award on behalf of Allen and Overy, and Yang Chen giving the award.
Thank you, Kate. I'm not carrying my ginger tea tonight. It's my cure for all ailments, so you know where I come from. Good evening, everybody. What an amazing room this is. 2.5 years ago, I stood before you as incoming president of AABANY, celebrating everything AABANY under this roof. 2.5 years later, despite the many challenges that we have faced, AABANY, its mission, its impact, its work has exceeded beyond everything that we imagined. So thank you, AABANY. We are so honored today, Allen and Overy is, to be receiving this award, which aligns with our values, as well as demonstrates our absolute commitment to diversity, equity, and inclusion, which we aim to incorporate in everything that we do at the firm, as well as in our interactions with our clients and our communities in New York and around the world.
And this award is a really wonderful acknowledgement to the dedication and commitment to all of the family members of Allen and Overy, who are so committed to seeing diversity, equity, and inclusion in every day and aspect of their lives, because we believe that diversity, equity, and inclusion makes us all better.
Thank you.
The Asian American Bar Association of New York is honored to present the 2022 AABANY Corporate Leadership Award to Flora Feng, Senior Legal Director of Global Research and Development, Intellectual Property at PepsiCo Incorporated. Flora received her undergraduate degree in chemical engineering from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. She then attended Georgetown University Law Center. After law school, Flora focused her practice on intellectual property law, gaining experience in patent litigation, prosecuting patent applications, and counseling clients on copyright and trademark registration and protection. Flora began her time at PepsiCo in March 2012, where she rose to Senior Legal Director of Global Intellectual Property. In this role, Flora oversees all legal matters in PepsiCo's global R&D for beverages and life sciences divisions, and provides support to PepsiCo's M&A team and design team.
I think the thing that strikes one about Flora, beyond her obvious intelligence and analytical capabilities, and I should add, her calm in the face of many storms, is her humanity. She's a very kind person and treats everyone, regardless of position, with respect and dignity, even when she's delivering a tough message. I see it with her team, her clients, and her colleagues.
I cannot say enough what a pleasure it has been to know Flora and to work with her as a lawyer. I think some of the things that really make her stand out is the fact that she is always calm. She deals with every adversity in just a very masterful way.
In the global intellectual property arena, Flora is a natural leader who remains committed to her corporate clients.
Working with Flora was just a joy. She handled some very difficult, sometimes very needy clients, in-house clients at Kraft Foods, where we both worked. Flora handled this with aplomb. She was always on top of everything that I asked her to do. And again, she had to deal with some people who could be very demanding, not always very reasonable. I never saw her lose her composure about anything.
Over the years, you really come to appreciate people like Flora, who goes about her job with a quiet confidence. She's a terrific people manager, and I can always depend that she will get the job done and will bring everyone along in the process.
One thing I do remember very fondly during the time that we worked together was a weekly video call that we would do to where Flora would update me on things and I would talk to her about any questions that I had. Those calls actually got to be a very fun part of my week. I now understand very clearly why people want to have dragon babies. Flora and I explored a lot of cultural topics that to this day keep us engaged.
In her spare time, Flora serves on the board of directors for Womankind NYC, a nonprofit organization providing multilingual and culturally responsive services to survivors of domestic violence, human trafficking, and sexual assault. Flora is also an active member of CHIPS, which stands for Chiefs in Intellectual Property, a nonprofit professional organization that advances and connects women with the goal of accelerating innovation through diversity of thought, participation, and engagement. Ladies and gentlemen, please join us in congratulating tonight's recipient of the 2022 AABANY Corporate Leadership Award, Flora Feng.
This is very exciting, and while we were waiting, Flora Feng's son told me some fun facts about Flora Feng. So you want to hear them? Yeah, because she's going to say some cool stuff about diversity, and it's going to get real serious in a second, but... So here's some fun facts about Flora Feng. During the pandemic, she bought an air fryer and an instant hot pot, but in true Asian mother style, she then subjected her entire family to boot camps every day so they could eat the fried food and then work it off and then eat the fried food and work it off. She's a paradox. She's a tiger mom, perhaps. I don't know. What do you think? Is she a tiger mom? A little bit. He won't admit it because he's sitting right there and he doesn't want to get sent to Kumon like we talked about before. All right. Presenting this award in all seriousness is our immediate past president. Again, please welcome Terry Shen and Flora Feng.
Ladies and gentlemen, Flora Feng.
Oh, my God. That's what I get for bringing my teenage son. So Thank you to AABANY for this incredible honor. When I looked up the previous awardees, I was completely humbled, and I'm still scratching my head as to how I could be included on that same list. And when I told my mom I got the award, she said, "Oh, I'm really sorry I can't be there. She's in Taipei. She just had cataract surgery." But she said, "But you know, you should invite, like, you know, your husband, your kids, your aunt and uncle in New Jersey should come. Your brother should probably fly out from California and get your cousins." And I'm like, "But mom, you have to pay." And she's like, "Oh, okay, never mind." So, so I celebrated 10 years with PepsiCo this past March, and that's the longest I've ever worked with anybody or anywhere. And 5 of those years were spent in Bangkok because PepsiCo gave a patent attorney the opportunity to be general counsel in Asia, something that I don't think I ever would have foreseen. And as one of my colleagues said, one of the reasons why we work for a company like PepsiCo is for opportunities like this. And it truly was a life-changing experience for me and for my family. And one of the things that really kind of struck me was when I was over there, I was no longer hyphenated. I wasn't Asian American, I was just the American. My parents came from Taiwan to the US as graduate students, and they were sending money home and creating a new life here. And I'm so grateful to them for making that decision. And it wasn't until I moved my family over to Thailand that I really understood like how difficult that is to leave your home country and settle somewhere new. But when I came back to New York in 2019, I really wanted to kind of get back into the New York scene. And thanks to my good friend Narges Gakalia at Mintz Levin, I joined the board of Womankind. And it's been great. And for the first time tonight, I met Yasmin Hamza, the CEO, in person. She's here somewhere. Shout out to Yasmin. And Mei Xie, one of my fellow board members, is here tonight as well. So applause for them. It's Womankind's 40th anniversary this year, so hopefully I'll see you all at the gala later this year. And at PepsiCo, I also have the privilege of working with some amazing, talented lawyers who are sitting right over there, including my manager, my colleague, Cynthia Sherida. And we also have a non-lawyer, Jim Lee, our Senior Vice President and Chief Strategy and Transformation Officer. He is a staunch supporter of the Asian American Associates at PepsiCo and of lawyers. So, thanks for coming, Jim. And also a big thank you for all my friends who are sitting out there. And I think there are other people in this room that I have known longer than I'd like to admit. There are a lot of people in here that I have read about and seen over the many decades. And I hope I can get to know you, not like in a stalker way or anything. I really admire all these people here. And finally, let me just say that the reason I get up every morning, literally, is for my family. My corporate career began soon after my first child, Ian, the one sitting over there, was born, and juggling billable hours and a toddler schedule was not really my thing. So now Ian's about to graduate from high school, and he's here with me tonight as my date because my husband's traveling on business. So thank you, Ian, for being my firstborn and for motivating me to make this move in-house. And my eighth grader, Leah, is home tonight taking care of my fifth grader, Derek. So thanks to them as well. And of course, my husband, Jeff Slater, who is my partner in everything, my rock, my supporter. He hauled all three kids to Thailand with me. Finally, thank you to Joe, Carrie, Will, and Shirley, and all the organizers tonight. This is a fabulous event. It's so great to see everybody out in New York again. Thanks.
It's with my pleasure that I present you with the award.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is my great privilege and honor to present, to bring out the first woman governor in New York State. Please welcome Governor Kathy Hochul.
Good evening. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you. Doesn't it feel great to be out in person again? Dressing up, putting the Zoom pajamas aside, and putting on some really nice fancy clothes. This is fantastic. It's a sign of our resiliency and the New York City comeback. And I want to congratulate this incredible organization, the Asian American Bar Association. I was at your founders event last October and had a chance to celebrate 32 extraordinary years of your success and the incredible growth in membership. But I believe we're on the cusp of an explosive growth in your membership, and here's why. For far too long, the voices of Asian Americans have not been heard or recognized at the highest levels of government or in opportunities in the legal profession. The numbers have not matched the growth in actual population, but there's an opportunity here to change that and start changing it right now. It's about who we appoint to positions when we have positions of power and we can lift people up. I have had many conversations with representatives of the Asian community, and I've said, your time is now. You've waited long enough for the recognition of your contributions and the legacy and the story, but also you need to be at the seats of power and now. And that is why, as your governor, in the 8 months, feels like 8 years, but that's okay, that I've been your governor, I have operated with intentionality, reaching out, saying, who can I appoint where and when? And I'm very excited to be interviewing individuals, representatives of this community, for positions in the legal profession, internally and externally, and on the bench in particular. Because we have a huge shortage, my friends, a shortage. What is no longer acceptable. Because, as I said, your time is now. I'm also very excited. I want to thank Young Chen for his leadership of this organization and others like William Ng, the president, Karen Kim coming in. Let's give them a round of applause. Terry Shen, the past president, Kate Rigg. They are also the people working in partnership with me to make sure that the voices of the Asian community are lifted up and heard. I'm very excited to be announcing the appointment of the first Asian American ever to the Empire State Development Board of Directors, overseeing billions of dollars of investments throughout the state. John Huang is going to now represent this community in a powerful way, bringing his experience with the Asian business community to bear. So I'm very excited about that. We are also looking for opportunities at the bench. My administration itself is so reflective of this community, but I did that because I needed to. I had to right the wrongs of the past. And whether it's bringing in young interns who might see themselves someday as a future governor, as I was once an intern long time ago, I want to create the pathway for more Asian Americans. So you have my support, you have my commitment, and my undying belief that the time for the Asian community to rise up and be heard and recognized and valued and have your place of the power is right now. Right now it's happening, and I'm going to make sure that it happens. Thank you very much, everybody. Enjoy your evening. Thank you.
So this is the time of night when I have the I don't know, honor perhaps, to welcome all the judges, elected officials, bar leaders, and other dignitaries in the room. And I'm not trying to interrupt your dinner. I know you're all still eating, so that's fine. It's okay if you talk over me, I don't mind that. But please, when our next set of honorees come up and speak, please give them the courtesy of your attention. And then I'll now do my usual recognition of the important people in the room. And I start with a disclaimer. This list is based on information current as of earlier today. If I omitted your name, my apologies. If I got your title wrong, blame Google. All right, so the judges, let's start with the U.S. Circuit Court, Second Circuit Court of Appeals, Honorable Denny Chen. U.S. District Court, Eastern District of New York, the Honorable Diane Gujarati. Honorable Pamela Chen. Now moving to our state courts, starting with New York State Supreme, Kings County, the Honorable Lillian Wan. The Honorable Donald Leo. From New York Supreme Court, New York County, we welcome Honorable Margaret Chan. Honorable Robert Reed. Honorable James E. DeAugust. From our New York Supreme Court in Queens County, the Honorable Bruno DiBiase. The Honorable Wyatt Gibbons. The Honorable Toko Sarita. And congratulations also to Toko. She was just named the statewide coordinating judge for the problem-solving courts. Moving now to our New York City Civil Court, New York County. We're very honored to have the supervising judge, the Honorable Shahabuddin Ali, also the president of the Asian American Judges Association of New York. Honored to have with us here tonight the Honorable Christopher Chin, Honorable Richard Tsai, Honorable John Zhuo Wang, and the Honorable Judy Kim. From New York City Civil Court in Queens County, Honorable Wendy Lee. From our New York Housing Court in Bronx County, the Honorable Sharab Ibrahim. From our Criminal Court in Bronx County, the Honorable Vidya Papachan. And the Honorable Jiyang An. Okay. I'll have to come back later and find that missing page, but apologies to the judges I'm gonna miss in the next, all right. And we also have some bar leaders in the room. That's on that missing page, so sorry, bar leaders. But we do have some important people from NPABA, the mothership. Happy to say also that AABANY is the biggest NPABA affiliate out of about 90 across the country, but great to have NPABA here represented. We have in the room NPABA's executive director, Priya Purandare. Also, we have with us NPABA director, Kristen Hagen. And very pleased to have our Northeast regional governors, James Lee and Anna Mercado Clark. And I'd be remiss to not acknowledge Dale Ho. He was nominated by President Biden for the Southern District of New York last fall. He's currently the Director of Voting Rights at the ACLU, and we hope that the Senate will approve his nomination very soon. Thank you for finding the missing page so I can continue honoring our other judges. From the New York City Criminal Court, Queens County, the Honorable Joanne Waters, Supervising Judge. From New York City Criminal Court, Kings County, the Honorable Curtis Farber and the Honorable Gilbert Hong. From the New York City Criminal Court, New York County, we have the Supervising Judge, the Honorable Kevin McGrath in the room. Also with us, Honorable Kate Peck, Honorable Phyllis Chu, and the Honorable James Clines. New York City Criminal Court, Richmond County, Honorable Biju Koshi is here. And we're honored also by the presence of our retired Appellate Division's First Department Appellate Term Judge, the Honorable Doris Ling Cohan. I want to recognize the other government officials that were here tonight. Governor Kathy Hochul was here, she was great. With her was also Linda's son, her Deputy Chief of Staff, and Linda is the highest ranked Asian in New York State government, so it's great to have Linda here. Also want to recognize Sandra Ung, New York City Councilwoman from the 20th Council District. Fun fact, Sandra was a former AABANY treasurer. Also with us, Kevin Kim, New York City Department of Small Business Services, Commissioner. Another fun fact, Kevin Kim was our development director a couple of years ago on the board. Thank you, Kevin. Also in the room, David Chang, Section Chief, Queens District Attorney's Office. And we're happy to welcome Beverly Ma, the Deputy Chief of Staff, Bronx County District Attorney's Office. The bar leaders in the room. Let's give it up for Eve Gjergen, President, Network of Bar Leaders. Let's recognize Vincent Chang, President, New York County Lawyers Association, and former AABANY president before me in 2007. We want to give a shout out to Austin D'Souza, the AABANY president. We want to give a shout out to our officers from Follow New York, John Lim and Louise Lingat. We have from ALDEF, Shirley Eng, community organizer, and Jerry Vatamala, director of ALDEF's Democracy Program. Shout out to Gene Kang, Calagni president. He was here early during the reception. And big shout out to Dan Brody, president of CAPABA. And I would be remiss to not recognize Simone Chung, Survivor season 35, right here in this room at the Scadden table. Go visit our table 29. Don't worry, Simone, we won't vote you off this island. And finally, if there are any law students in the room, or if you know of any law students in the room that would like a $5,000 scholarship to fund work that they're doing this summer for an organization dedicated to Asian American causes, we have the AAPI Public Service Scholarship. The application has been extended till tomorrow, April 29th. So law students, I know you have finals to worry about, but send your application in. And like I said, if you know of any law students who want to fund their summer work for Asian organizations, please tell them to sign up. And actually, AAPI would love to have your donations to fund the scholarship. For those of you that don't know, AAPI stands for Asian American Law Fund of New York. They are the 501c3 nonprofit arm of AABANY. They're helping us with the T3 project. So if you want to give to AAPI, please see Sylvia Chin, the AAPI president. She's sitting at the White and Case table at table 28. And at this time, I'll return you to your dinner and bring back to the stage Kate Rigg.
don't think anyone told Yang Chen what a fun fact was, because being the treasurer is not really that fun as a fact, Yang, or being on a committee. Also, what we've learned is pretty much everybody at every single table is important here tonight. There are some honorable people and some less honorable people, but everybody's important. I'm looking at you, table 79. The judges at table 79 are wasted. They all gave me their business cards. I'm like, do you think I have traffic tickets? Why are you giving me your business card? I'm excited though, because I've never had a Supreme Court judge business card in my wallet before, but then someone told me the Supreme Court in New York's not really that supreme. So it was kind of a disappointment. Oh no, there goes my show sponsorship that I'd negotiated earlier that we were gonna do as some kind of patronage move. I learned that in high school. Okay, fun fact about Yang Chen, because you know, I made people send me their own fun facts, and Yang wrote basically like a, I would call this like an SAT answer. It was a paragraph form. When the pandemic started, AABANY events went remote. I had a lot of extra time, so I did more baking. I baked some pies, including my first lemon meringue pie, my first cherry pie made with sour cherries from the green market. Thank you for telling us where you shop, Yang, just in case anybody needs to run into him on the fly sometime. Go to the green market. And my first pumpkin pie for Thanksgiving using a real pumpkin. I don't know, I never asked you if you were single, but ladies, if Yang is single, real pumpkin in the pumpkin pie. It even says, I swear I didn't write this, not pumpkin puree from a can. Go big or go home, Yang Chen. That's what I say. If you're gonna take up baking, get crazy. May even get some like some vintage Crisco from some old store and get really crazy. Oh, that joke could have gone in so many directions. That's why I'm looking down in shame. Now look, look at my new t-shirt, everyone. Where's the camera? Yes. I'm wearing a token white guy t-shirt, and let me say why. Because as an Asian American artist here with you this evening, I can tell you that tokenism and exclusion are two of the hallmarks of what happens to American Asians and Asian American artists in this country in general. And you should listen to this part, it's important. There's been a lot of violence against Asian Americans in this country in this pandemic and post-pandemic time because of the stress that we are all feeling. And what I mean by that is when microaggressions exist in a culture, name calling, asking your Asian friend who's been here for four generations, where are you from? That kind of thing. That's a microaggression. It's not that big a deal. You can correct it in the moment. However, in times of societal stress, microaggressions become macroaggressions. And so that's why I'm asking you today, first of all, to continue to support your Asian American artist friends, such as myself. Follow them on Instagram, go to their shows, buy their albums, actually buy a ticket to see their movie. You've got to show up for them because the white people are not gonna show up for them and the other cultures in this country until we do it ourselves. We have to get proactive. It's not just about a hashtag. I don't give a shit about your hashtag #OscarsSoWhite. Who cares? Are you gonna go and support the first Asian American Hamilton when he has a cabaret at Studio 54? Are you gonna pull out your phone and find me on Instagram and follow my ass? Because people look at that, at Kate Rigg NYC. So all I'm saying is, this is how we enter Asian Americans into the cultural conversation, which makes people understand that we are Americans and not like a foreign visiting menace. This is hundreds of years old, by the way, this misperception, and we have the opportunity now to galvanize and actually do something about it. And finally, I want to say to everyone here tonight, keep coming to this event. This is part of it. Celebrating each other's achievements. uplifting each other, amplifying each other's voices, giving ourselves awards, recognizing our contributions to society. And I know that you get a lot of woohoo as lawyers and judges, you get a lot of crap out there. So this is a place you can come and really celebrate the fact that you didn't go to medical school and instead you became people who could actually change legislation, be part of recruiting voters, and actually make a change in this country. So I applaud you for being here. Please keep coming back. Put the graphic up now, please. Put the graphic up. Yes, now look. Since we first started talking about this, you cheap asses have only donated 496. It's like the ghost of my mother is here. My mother right now would be going around to all the tables taking breadsticks and putting them in her purse for later, okay? That's how... It's funny because it's true. I see 490. This is shameful. So everybody pull out your phones and you're going to do two things right now. First, you're going to follow me on Instagram, at Kate Rigg NYC. But more importantly, you're going to text the words TIDE3 to 44-321. Table 79, you're too drunk. Stop buying drinks. I want to see you... Text this number. I know you're civil servants, most of you. Just donate $25, okay? But everybody else, corporate lawyers, I expect you to donate between $300 and $400. Public defense attorneys, you know, we'll contribute to your fund afterwards, okay? But this is a serious project. See, everybody turns off when you ask for money, but I'm just gonna stand here until I see this number go up because it's live on my phone. This project, everyone, is so important. Violence against Asian Americans is severely underreported in this country, partly because of our own shame, partly because of the obstacles to reporting it effectively. I want to tell you that for 9 months in 2021, there were 237 reported incidents of violence against Asian Americans in New York City. Only 60 of them actually went through the courts as hate crimes. That's 20% or so. I went to Juilliard, but I still know some math. And then only 7 of those were actually fully prosecuted. This is a terrible low number. And I don't know about you, but I'm tired of carrying pepper spray and a switchblade in the subway. Ladies, you know what I'm talking about. Who here in this year, just by show of hands, who has bought a weapon this year to carry in the subway? Look, see? I know the judges over there did it, yeah. I personally have a pepper spray, a blade, a brass knuckles, and a thing that you swing that makes noise. I don't want to have that anymore, everybody. Oh, look at that. That's what I'm talking about. Thank you very much, Anonymous. Thank you, Jeannie Lynn. Thank you, Char. Look at those. Oh, I didn't know you could see their actual. Now the shame is really going to take over the room. I like the 102.56. It's like you're ahead of time calculating your tax deduction. So you just added that little bit that you 51.43. It's very specific. Kathy Chen, $500, everybody. Jennifer Wu, $250. We hit our goal already. Keep going, though, because you're proving to me that the ghost of my mother no longer has to collect breadsticks and sell them outside to raise money for this thing. You're doing it. I love you very much, all of you. And I hope you do follow me on Instagram because I have lots of great information about Asian American arts in New York City. All right. I'm gonna leave the stage now because I know we've gone over a little bit, but it was worth it. It was worth it, Tech Booth. Here comes some more awards. Thank you very much for being here. Oh, and the token white guy in me says, yeah, dude, that was really cool. Thank you so much for supporting. What is this event about again? Multicultural something? Yeah, okay, so thank you very much for being here and doing that. I love to see it. I love to see it, and we're gonna show you some videos now and bring some more award winners up. Thank you, everybody.
The Asian American Bar Association of New York is honored to present the 2022 AABANY Women's Leadership Award to Emily Kim, founder and CEO of Zeta Charter Schools. Emily received her undergraduate degree from the University of Pennsylvania, where she also obtained a Master of Arts in English.
She then obtained a Master of Education for teaching English at Teachers College, Columbia University. Emily started her career in education, teaching English at a New York public high school. Emily eventually returned to school, obtaining her law degree from Columbia Law School. Following law school, Emily went into private practice, focusing on commercial and securities litigation as an associate at Sherman & Sterling, where she worked until her clerkship for the Honorable Dora L. Irizarry, United States District Court Judge for the Eastern District of New York.
The moment I met her, she just exuded grace and confidence, humility and intelligence. And I could tell that there was a spectacular woman there before me. And she did not disappoint. She hit the ground running during the clerkship, tackling many difficult cases, criminal cases, trials, civil cases, habeas, Social Security appeals, you name it, she handled it.
After her clerkship, Emily returned to litigation as an associate at Arnold & Porter. There, Emily took on a case pro bono for Success Academy Charter Schools, which launched Emily's return to education when Success Academy offered her the opportunity to become its first general counsel, then chief policy and legal officer, and finally the executive vice president of policy and legal affairs.
She's able to merge this incredible IQ, an incredible drive, a focus, a determination, a real hard edge, in the best sense of the word, of capability and demand for excellence, with this incredible EQ and a very high EQ, an incredible sense of mission.
But what is really amazing about Emily is that she's a role model, not just for women, she's a role model for anyone who wants to be successful. You have to dream it, you have to imagine it in order to be it. And that is Emily. She works hard, she's visionary, and she's humble, and she gives back at every turn.
In 2017, Emily stepped down from Success Academy to launch her own network of schools, Zeta Charter Schools, with current locations spanning from Inwood to the Bronx. Emily founded Zeta Charter Schools to create high-performing, data-driven, and innovative public schools.
She's had success in the private sector. She could have had tremendous continued success in the private sector, and she could have done anything she wanted. The fact that she's chosen to work this hard and be this dedicated to kids and changing kids' lives is really inspirational, I think, for all of us in the private sector.
She is an inspiration to me in the way that she's given back to the community, to students, to law students, and in helping to select judges through AABANY's committees. And so congratulations to Emily. You absolutely deserve this honor. And congratulations to AABANY for choosing her.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join us in congratulating tonight's recipient of the 2022 AABANY Women's Leadership Award, Emily Kim.
All right, coming to the stage now to present this award is President William Eng, and Emily Kim is going to give an acceptance speech, and you all are going to listen to this one because Asian American women have been silenced so much in the last couple of years. So Don Leo and table, put down your cocktails and listen to this one, all right? Here they are giving out the award for the Women's Leadership Award. Here they are.
Good evening. I'm honored and humbled to receive this award. Thank you. Okay. Before I begin, I want to acknowledge the current moment we are all in. Over the past 2 years, we as Asians in America have experienced sorrow and rage over the loss of a sense of safety and security, and over a feeling of powerlessness to protect those we most want and need to protect. We have witnessed violent attacks against our mothers and fathers, grandparents, brothers and sisters, as they take their morning walks, as they're riding the subway, going grocery shopping, taking out the trash, and traveling to church. And so I want to add my voice tonight to insisting that enough is enough. We owe no justification for why we are here. We owe no endless proof of loyalty. We owe no demonstration of our worthiness as citizens of this country that we too helped build, shape, and fight for. In fact, our nation owes us loyalty, protection, equal voice, and access to opportunity. Our parents deserve to walk these streets in safety and peace. Our children deserve to live and play and learn without racist invectives hurled at them. So enough is enough. I stand in solidarity with all of you tonight in this. I'm delighted to share with you tonight my mission, my passion, and my life's work at the organization I founded and lead today, Zeta Charter Schools. Zeta is actually a love story. This is my family. I have three kids, Aiden, Carter, and Zachy, and I would do everything in my power to make sure they have access to excellent education and life opportunity. This is a map of our city, and I'm not sure if you can make it out, but each red dot is a charter school application submitted by a parent seeking to enroll their child in a free public charter school. My three children have been one of these red dots over the years, and so I know that each dot is some parent's love story for their child. Now, where the red dots are most concentrated, those are the lowest income areas of New York City, where the city's worst performing schools are also concentrated. In these schools, an astounding 80% of children cannot read, write, or do math on grade level. I am opening schools in these areas where schools are failing kids. In contrast to the vast failure in far too many schools, at the end of our first year at Zeta, 90% of our students finished the year on or above grade level. During COVID, when public school students across the city and nation fell even further behind, our Zeta students grew 1 year on average in reading. Despite the immense challenges of the pandemic, we never stopped or let up. We were the first elementary schools to reopen our doors to full-time in-person learning in August 2020 at the height of the pandemic. Our students showed tremendous growth in academics. We opened new schools and we more than doubled the size of our organization. Today we have 5 elementary school campuses serving 1,500 children, and we are well on our way to serving 13,000 children year over year in 25 schools that are elementary, middle, and high schools in the next 10 years. I'm often asked why I made the leap from corporate litigator to education reform leader. For me, the answer is simple and rooted in love. Growing up, my family and I lived in Ames, Iowa, and my father, who was our family's primary breadwinner, passed away when I was 11 years old. My mother decided to stay here in the United States, in Iowa, to give greater opportunity to my two sisters and me. But it was hard times without my father, and it's only now as an adult that I fully appreciate the sacrifices she made, the doggedness, the determination to launch my two sisters and me to our best possible lives. I start with Zeta as a love story. I start with Zeta as a love story because I see myself and my mother in so many of the children and families we serve at Zeta. The same love, the same determination to never give up for one's kids. We may come from very different backgrounds and walks of life. Our ancestors hail from different continents, but what unites us is a parent's love for their child. I know that love as a child of my parents and as a mother to my three sons. This love fuels our work at Zeta. We of all communities know that access to excellent education is foundational to access to opportunity and upward mobility. In a country both welcoming and marginalizing us, my education equipped me with the fundamental tools I needed to forge my own path to self-actualization. The work I do now fighting for educational equity at Zeta Charter Schools brings my own story full circle. The fact that there are so many children right here in New York City who do not have access to excellent education troubles me deeply. And it should trouble us all as advocates, as parents, as beneficiaries of the powerful gift of transformative education, and as citizens, particularly as we contemplate the state of our nation in this time. And so I am on a mission to ensure that every child has access to the highest quality free public education from pre-kindergarten to 12th grade, because excellent education is the right of every child. I leave you tonight with this challenge. Harness the power of your past experiences, your talents, your legal skills, your resources to fight for an equitable world. Rise up, give back, protest and make noise. Be audacious and fearless. Engage in pro bono work that changes the status quo. If not you, this powerful room of New York City Asian American attorneys, then who? You have my name if you would like to join me in this important work of fighting for educational equity for every child. I await your call. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Emily, for that. We appreciate you so much. We're gonna keep it moving so you can get through these delicious desserts together. I wanna thank everybody who actually turned the tide on the Turn the Tide donation pledges. I'm not gonna bug you about it right now. You think I am, but I'm not. Because I just ate some sugar and the token white guy in me wants to go somewhere and smoke some soon to be legal pot. I don't smoke pot, I'm Asian. I don't even drink, I do nothing. I study, that's it. Judges. All right. It says that I just say thank you, Emily, and then what do? Just get off the stage? Anybody? Yang? Yang's telling me to get off the stage. Where's your cardboard cutout? Let me see it. Yang brought his own cardboard cutout to dinner because in true Asian style, you know, when a dinner's free, you might want to get two, right? So you can bring one home and make a picnic for later. I wasn't kidding. Look at this, everybody. I feel comforted having Young Chen on stage with me, because did you all know that he's a ballroom dancer? You did? That was one of his fun facts. I'll spare you the essay, the SAT essay he wrote me on ballroom dancing, but it was exciting, let me tell you. Go big or go home, Young. All right, it's hard to get me off a stage once I step onto it. Yeah. Now I'm literally getting the hook. Okay, we're going next to the Don H. Liu Scholars section. Here I go. Video.
Don H. Liu Scholars Program was founded in 2014 by two past presidents of the Asian American Bar Association of New York. The program seeks to identify, cultivate, and inspire future Asian American leaders within the legal profession by providing mentorship to ensure that each scholar starts his or her career at a prominent law firm.
It really started with Mike Huang, who called me one day on behalf of AABANY, who wanted to start a scholarship focused on financially needed students among APAs. Now, the scholars themselves are intimately involved in the program, both socially, professionally, and generally interacting with each other and training each other to help each other grow professionally.
I'm a first generation immigrant. My family came to the United States when I was 7 years old. And so my parents are refugees, as am I, and we don't have the network or the knowledge of what attorneys or what a legal career is like.
DHL has provided me with tons of networking opportunities, all the way from talking to other DHL scholars who are just a couple of years ahead of me in law school or working full time, to mentors who have had years of experience in the legal space.
One of the earliest memories of the program that I have is from the acceptance dinner after I was selected. I remember meeting all the program members, and everyone that I met was singularly focused on helping make sure that I had all the resources and support that I needed to finish my first year on a strong note.
My favorite part about being a DHL scholar is definitely the family. You know, getting to meet the other scholars, getting to meet the mentors, getting to meet the people behind the program has been an incredible experience and an incredibly empowering experience.
The senior members of our community continue to make themselves available even as I advance as a lawyer. They offer their time to me generously. They talk to me about different career paths. They talk to me about their experiences. And talking to them really encouraged me to become a leader in our community.
The one word that I would use to describe this program is family.
Optimism.
Supportive.
Family.
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 In today's world, racial equity is a term that's used often. But I view Scholars Program as the ultimate investment in racial equity.
Hey, good evening. My name is Mike Huang. I'm the president of the DHL Scholarship. So one of the favorite things for me for running the scholarship definitely has to be reading the applications every year, because I always get inspired. So it is a privilege for me tonight to share with you a little bit about the stories of our three new scholars this year. And while these days, I will say that you may focus on the hardships and the challenges they overcome, and I would say don't be discouraged. I would try to look at the hope and the inspiration that each of their stories gives us. So our first scholar this year is Edward Jung. Edward is currently a 1L at Harvard Law School. Born and raised in Sacramento, California, like so many children of immigrants, Edward did not have the luxury of a carefree childhood. Early mornings and late nights were spent at his family's small ice cream shop, juggling both the burdens of school and helping his family. But what really stands out about Edward is his ability to maintain a sense of optimism and hope despite all of his and his family's struggles and hardships. I'm going to read a snippet from Edward's essay that he submitted for the scholarship that really helps encapsulate this point. Edward wrote, "Our cold restaurant is also where I once slept, huddled in a sleeping bag with my family when we were kicked out of my aunt's home. When packing my books, going to school in the morning, it never occurred to me we were homeless. Life was a dichotomy of optimism and reality. I quickly learned to operate with a hopeful smile. Though I no longer sleep on the shop floor, as a first-generation law student and American, I'll never forget those nights. My dreams, looking up at the ceiling and hoping to understand what a better future could even look like, have evolved into my determination now in yearning to pave the way for a better opportunity for my family." So Edward, I would say, you know, based on what I just read, you asked the question of what a better future could even look like. And I would say, if you look around you tonight, your future is looking pretty good. So congratulations, Edward.
So our next DHL scholar is Sung Hae Young, who also goes by Sheng. Sheng is a first-year law student at Boston College Law School and hopes to pursue a career in corporate law following graduation. She graduated magna cum laude from SUNY Binghamton. SUNY. Sheng was born in Korea and moved to Queens, New York when she was 3. Her parents made this decision in hopes to provide her with the best education possible. However, in trying to provide for a better life for his family, Sheng's father was scammed into purchasing a storefront that he could not afford to pay. In the midst of his financial and legal troubles, Sheng's father sought aid from lawyers, but was scoffed at and turned away. Her father eventually gave up on seeking legal aid, and under the strains of mounting debt and despair, he took his own life. This tragedy not only motivated Chung to attend law school, but to do better in helping the Asian American community at large and other marginalized groups. While at Binghamton, Sheng utilized her position as vice president of her sorority to spread awareness of Asian American issues. During COVID, Sheng drafted speeches on the uptick of hate crimes against Asian Americans in the history of Asian Americans in the United States. In the face of extreme hardship and challenges, Sheng did not give up and always finds ways to help and improve her community. And that resilience and willingness to give back is why we selected her as a DHL scholar. Congratulations, Sheng. So our final DHL scholar is Brian Liu. Brian was born in San Francisco, in Chinatown in San Francisco, to a father who worked as a courthouse janitor and a mother who worked as a factory seamstress. His parents, courageous in their own right, uprooted themselves from Southeast China to come to the U.S. to pursue their American dreams. They worked tirelessly towards that goal until that dream was shattered when Brian's father was diagnosed with a terminal illness. As a result, at the age of 9, Brian began spending his weekends carting a yellow mop around the courthouse to assist his ailing father, whose strength began to falter. Despite this incredible hardship, Brian graduated summa cum laude from University of Pennsylvania. After graduation, Brian excelled as a legal assistant at Google and as a military intelligence officer at the U.S. Army Reserve. He continued to apply his smarts and drive to tackle assignments that required skills and judgments beyond his years of experience. However, what made Brian, and what made us see Brian as a true DHL scholar, was his willingness to give back to the community, whether through advocating for first-generation low-income Penn applicants, or spearheading an initiative to showcase prominent Asian American veterans at Google. Brian is a first-year law student at Yale and exploring a career in privacy and cybersecurity law. He continues to serve as a reservist U.S. Army officer, and in his spare time, he is a columnist for Lawfare, a blog dedicated to national security issues. So, unfortunately, Brian can't be here tonight, so we'll make sure to get his trophy up to New Haven. But otherwise, if we can take this time, I would like to congratulate Edward, Brian, and Sheng again on behalf of the Don H. Liu Scholarship. We do congratulate you and welcome you to the family.
All right, everybody, we're almost done. The last remarks tonight belong to your president, William Eng. I want to tell you a couple of fun facts, though, before I bring William Eng up. Here's a fun fact. First of all, William Eng, I was like, why are you 12 and the president of AABANY? Dude looks good. And his fun fact had to do with 2011. I'm like, when did you join AABANY? Like, when you were in high school? So in 2011, William Eng, they had a basketball team with former AABANY president William Wang and some other members of the APA legal profession. This was in 2011, you guys started a basketball team. Instead of talking about their stats as basketball players, he then went and talked about their stats as partners at various law firms. But I want to say also that probably William Eng, your president, was responsible for Lin's sanity, because only a year later, Jeremy Lin joined the Knicks. And I want to think that it's because he was inspired by these lawyers playing basketball. He's like, I can do better than that. Just wait a second, hold my beer, and came. Also a fun fact was that I don't know how fun this fact is, William. It says, I had planned a trip to Disney World during the pandemic. I mean, I guess that's a fun fact for your kids. Except that it's in Florida, so, you know, don't wear your pink t-shirts, if you know what I mean. All right, I'm not gonna get political. Don't get crazy, everybody. Don't get crazy, very Asian. I would like to tell you that we're only $1,500 away from raising a nice, clean $30,000. So if you didn't donate, I know there's at least 100 people in here who didn't donate. Hit me for $15, text 44321. It's easy to remember. I know you're Asian and you've had half a drink and you're wasted, but 44321 is easy. Just write Tide 3, 15 bucks, and we'll hit our goal. Somebody just donated $5. Ha ha, very funny. I can see this in real time. Let's go, everybody. By the time I get up here to say goodnight, I want there to be $30,000 in there. Please welcome your very sporty and youthful. He uses a lot of sunscreen. This is your president, William Eng, everybody.
Good evening, AABANY members, friends, and supporters. As AABANY president and chair of the 2022 Annual Dinner Planning Committee, I want to thank everyone for attending tonight's event. I want to give a special thanks to our law firm, corporate, and community sponsors for their continued generosity. And I want to thank the Planning Committee and the student volunteers for making tonight possible. I also want to take a moment to congratulate our honorees, Flora Feng and Emily Kim, for their outstanding accomplishments, leadership, and commitment to diversity. Now, tonight is special for many reasons. As you know, we are having our first post-pandemic in-person annual dinner in more than 2 years. I'm also proud to share that this is the first time all of our honorees and MC have been women. And as you saw earlier, this is the first time we've had a New York governor attend AABANY's annual dinner. And this is also the first time we've had AABANY's annual dinner in April. As many of you know, we typically have our dinner in February, but the Omicron variant had different plans for us this year. And from the number of emails and text messages that I received in January telling me you needed to move the dinner, we ended up moving the dinner. So thank you for that. Now, while there's plenty for us to celebrate tonight, we must also remember that people in our communities have not been so fortunate and lucky as us. The COVID-19 pandemic and hate and violence against the AAPI community continues to this day and continues to test our resolve. With that in our heart and our minds, our theme for this year is forging a new path to an equitable future. As you heard tonight, AABANY has been at the forefront of fighting anti-Asian hate and violence. We must continue to speak up, demand accountability from our elected officials, advocate for additional public and community resources, and offer solutions to address the inequities. As one of the leading bar associations in the country, AABANY remains dedicated to promoting the interests of AAPI attorneys. And in the upcoming year, we will work towards helping our members grow and obtain positions of influence, whether that be in the law firm, in-house, or government and public sector. We must continue to diversify the bench at all levels and in all courts. AABANY will continue to expand upon our award-winning pro bono clinics and strengthen our anti-Asian violence task force. On a lighter note, we look forward to hosting our signature events, the Summer Soiree, the Fall Conference, and the Founders Day event. The Summer Soiree will be on June 29th, and that will be an opportunity for our law firm sponsors and in-house council members to connect. We encourage all of you to attend, and law firm sponsors will be contacted. Now, for the past 2.5 years, we've heard many stories of perseverance and, unfortunately, tragedy in the AAPI community. I want to share a short story with you that hit close to home. A person that I look up to told me about an incident on the subway where he directly intervened when a guy was bothering an Asian woman who apparently did not understand English. He said words to the effect of, "leave her alone." But probably knowing him, he probably used some more choice words. Now, the guy on the subway turned his attention to my close friend, and he started to approach him. Now, my close friend is brave, but at that moment, he thought to himself, "holy mackerel, this dude is big." Luckily, the subway car was pulling into the station, and he and the woman were able to get out of the situation safely. Now, my first reaction, like many of you, would have been, "are you crazy? Why did you get involved?" And for those of you who have taken the bystander intervention training, you'll notice that my close friend skipped the other D's of distract, delegate, delay, and document. Now, I'm not suggesting that we all do what he did, but the point of this story is that ordinary people are doing extraordinary things to stand up for others and even strangers. And to that end, we, as members of the Bar Association, should also do our part to help others in the community. If not us as the Asian American Bar Association of New York, then who? So in closing, whether you're in the courtroom, boardroom, or even a Zoom room, which we hope you're not, and you're faced with making a decision that you believe is right and that you believe will help the AAPI community, I ask you to look around this room and remember all those people who are here to support you. Now, these are all ways in which you make a difference to advance the goal of a more equitable future. I want to thank first and foremost my firm, Littler Middleton, and my colleagues. I want to thank outgoing President Terry Shen, who did an amazing job during the pandemic. I also want to thank the AABANY board, directors, officers, and committee chairs, and our executive director, Young Chen. I also want to thank my wife, Christine, and our kids, because I couldn't serve as AABANY president without her love and continued support. Have a great evening, and I look forward to working with you all this year. I'd ask President-elect Karen Kim to come to the stage.
Good evening, everyone. It is my pleasure to close out tonight's program. After 2 years, tonight's dinner feels more like a family reunion. It's great to see so many new and familiar faces, and want to thank you for sharing your evening with us and supporting AABANY. Tonight's event reminds me of the importance of AABANY and building relationships so we can work together to support and advance both the legal community and the community at large. It is my privilege and honor to serve as president-elect, and I look forward to working alongside each of you this upcoming year. Thank you to our sponsors this evening, Broadridge, Kirkland & Ellis, for your support. Thank you to Governor Hochul for her remarks and support. And congratulations again to our honorees and Don Liu scholars. I'd like to also recognize and thank AABANY officers, board members, committee chairs, and each of you for all your support. And last but not least, I'd like to thank Kate Rigg for an amazing job tonight. And my most important announcement tonight is to invite you to our after party in the mezzanine. And be safe, be well, and have a good night. Thank you.
Oh, you didn't think I would let Karen Kim get off the stage without a couple of fun facts about her, did you? I mean, she's your president, you gotta know. Fun facts about President Karen Kim. President-elect, sorry. I got certified in scuba diving, but after becoming a parent, I have yet to actually scuba dive. You didn't have to tell us the second part. The first was okay. I like how Asians are like, I am awesome, but sometimes I don't feel so awesome, so maybe I'm not so awesome. No, that is your Asian mother in your head. My Asian mom is saying right now, still not too late for medical school. Why you wear black all the time? So depressing. I hate your father. He looks like a pig. Why are you so fat? I could go on. It just goes, it's a constant loop. So I do understand. Another fun fact about Karen Kim is I climbed Mount Kilimanjaro. Then she says a bunch of stuff about adverse effects from altitude medication, but I'm not gonna include that here. I am just gonna celebrate the first part, which is climbing Mount Kilimanjaro. See, the white half of me actually amplifies my achievements bigger than they actually are against the Asian part, which wants to diminish them all the time. All right, I wanna say goodnight. Thank you so much for being here. As I said before, these kinds of celebrations amplify, uplift, and empower our community. If any of you people want me to come out and host events for your law firms, please call me. I'm a gun for hire. I went to the Juilliard School. Nobody cares. It's not medical school. I'm not a lawyer and I'm not in government. Who cares? All right. Please follow me at KATERIGGNYC on Instagram. I'm going to take a quick look at this fundraising. You know, I wasn't kidding. This campaign is so important. We are literally the only people officially counting what's happening out there with hate crimes, trying to create a data source so we can report it. So look how close we are. 85 more people, if they give $15, we would hit $30,000. I made that up because, again, the white part of me doesn't do math, but I think that I'm right. So I need everybody to pull out your phones. Come on, 44321. You're gonna get an Uber and you know it's gonna be $85 to get home. So what's another 15 bucks? 443, there's $15 went right there. Thank you. See, look at that, okay? And if you're tired of me talking about it, give 100 bucks and we'll get there faster. 44321, and you just write T3 and how much money. I'm gonna leave it at that. Take it down so we don't shame them anymore. They've given enough. There's an after party, there's gonna be drinking, there's gonna be music, there's more dessert, which makes me very happy, and my Asian mom very unhappy. Ruth Bader Ginsburg says goodnight to everybody from the podium. Thank you all for being here. See you at the after party. Give me your business card. I'll think of something good to do with it. Good night, everybody. I hope you had a good time.